We are about to commemorate the centenary of the end of the First World War, the Great War of 1914-1918. November the 11th will mark the 100th anniversary to the day of the armistice, which ended a four-year conflict, a conflict described by the Westmeath Examiner as Armageddon. And this year, on November the 11th, the 11th, the 11th, here in All Saints Church, there will be, as there is every year, a service to commemorate those who gave their lives in that war and indeed in other conflicts throughout the 20th century. And people here in Westmeath may wonder, well, why are we commemorating this conflict? What had it to do with Mullingar, with Westmeath? Well, it had an awful lot, because during that war, nearly 300 men from this town of Mullingar, close to 10% of the male population of the town, lost their lives. Ireland was part of the United Kingdom at that time and so played a full part in the war, and men from all over this county served in the army, in the navy, and even in the Royal Air Force, which had its beginnings a century ago this year. They served in the armies of Canada and Australia, New Zealand, South Africa and the United States, as well as in the British forces. And these were men from all parts of Mullingar and from all parts of the county. Some were the aristocracy from the big houses, people like the Earl of Longford from Tullinally Castle, who was killed in 1915, or the Levings from Knockdrin Castle, just outside Mullingar. Others came from working class backgrounds in parts of Mullingar like Barrack Street, Mill Road, Patrick Street. There were shop assistants, there were farm labourers, there were our grandfathers and great uncles, there were people's husbands and sons and fathers and brothers. They were ours, and that's why I think it's important that they're commemorated, because sadly for far too long they were not, outside the memories of their own families, and sometimes not even in those memories. They were excluded from our national narrative, because in the eyes of many, they had fought in the wrong uniform for the wrong country. But these men saw themselves as fighting for Ireland and dying for Ireland. Ireland was about to get home rule, and they saw it as their duty to fight for Ireland and to show that Ireland was worthy of self-government. Those who served in the war from Mullingar and other parts of Westmeath bore witness to the horrors of that conflict. Private Matthew Dignan from Mullingar wrote a letter to his father describing how he climbed over the bodies of his dead comrades at the Somme. Another soldier from the town wrote a vivid description of seeing a man decapitated by a shell a few metres away from him. Colonel Howard Bury of Belvedere House witnessed the first use of flamethrowers in Belgium in the summer of 1915, and took part in an operation where nearly every man under his command was wiped out. And some of the most vivid accounts of the war come from the extraordinary diaries of Private Edward Rowe from Cool, who was a soldier right through the war. He was a professional soldier, and his diaries, which are in a museum in Preston in England — he belonged to a Lancashire regiment — offer an extraordinary account of the conflict. If you want to know what it's like to be shot, what it is actually like to be shot, Private Rowe tells you, because he was shot in the arm at Ypres in May of 1915. He was present at the Christmas truce in December 1914 and describes hearing men singing hymns together and exchanging presents across no man's land. He also served in a firing squad during the Gallipoli campaign, and he describes what that was like. He was in Baghdad when the historic ancient city fell after 400 years of Turkish occupation, and records how during that time he recalled his childhood reading the stories of the Arabian Nights. In one of his entries, he talks about how the flu, meaning the Spanish flu, the lethal pandemic which swept around the world in 1918 and killed far more than the war itself, had come to the land of the two rivers, Mesopotamia, which we now of course know as Iraq. Men from Westmeath fought with great courage, and many of them received decorations for their courage. Colonel Howard Bury was one of many to win the Distinguished Service Order, and the equivalent of that order for other ranks, the DCM, Distinguished Conduct Medal, was won by three Mullingar men in the space of a couple of weeks: Sergeant Michael Dunn, Sergeant Thomas Leonard, and Sapper James McLaughlin. And several other men from the town also won awards. And the highest bravery award in the British Army, rarely given, is the Victoria Cross. And Westmeath can boast of having had two Victoria Cross winners during the Great War. The first was Maurice Deese, who came from Turbotstown House in Coole, but spent part of his childhood at Levington Park in Mullingar. Maurice Deese was one of the first British soldiers killed in the war. He died near the town of Mons on the 23rd of August 1914, and in his last hour of life he was manning a machine gun trying to hold the Germans back, and for his extraordinary heroism he was posthumously awarded the Victoria Cross. And in 2014, presidents and kings from across Europe paid tribute to him at the grave where he's buried at St. Symphorien, just outside the Belgian town of Mons. A year after Maurice Deese had won the Victoria Cross, a second Westmeath man won the VC, and this was Captain George Arthur Boyd Rochford from Middleton Park in Castletown Gagan. He saw a grenade landing in his trench, ran over, picked it up, ran up the parapet and threw it back out again, saving the lives of many of his men. Happily he survived and returned home in September 1915 with his VC, and hundreds of people packed the railway station here in Mullingar to welcome him home. Mullingar men fought on every front in the war. Some of them fought right through the conflict, and they saw historic events. They were there at the Battle of the Somme, they were there at Messines when the Ulster 36th Division and the 16th Irish Division, Protestant and Catholic, Unionist and Nationalist, fought side by side. And at Messines there is now the Irish Peace Park, a beautiful commemoration of the Irish from all over the island who served in the war. And that Peace Park was opened 20 years ago by President Mary McAleese and Queen Elizabeth and the then King of Belgium. And it includes a round tower, symbolic of Ireland. And there's a very close connection between Mullingar and that round tower, because the stone for the tower came from part of the old workhouse here in Mullingar, a building that had become derelict and was taken down. The stone was sent out to Belgium, and some local men were involved in the construction of that tower, along with young people from every county of Ireland. And it's appropriate because apparently at least one of the Irishmen buried in Belgium, a victim of the Great War, was a man who had actually been born in the workhouse in Mullingar. So many of those who died in the conflict, they came from the very poorest parts of Ireland, the poorest areas of towns and cities. As was described about one young Westmeath man who died, he is a poor man's son. And so we have this connection to this beautiful memorial which commemorates all those from this island who served in that war. In 1915, a young soldier about to head off to war had a party before he left, and he said goodbye to the local military chaplain, Father Bernard Farrell. He never imagined, as he later wrote to his father, that when he said goodbye to Father Farrell in Mullingar, that they would meet again on the banks of the Euphrates. Because in 1918, this soldier was stationed in what was then known as Mesopotamia, now Iraq, in the city of Basra. And he was walking down the streets of Basra one day when, to his amazement, he met Father Farrell. By 1918, Father Farrell was a military chaplain serving in Mesopotamia. He had enlisted as a military chaplain at the start of the war, and having initially worked in the barracks here, he then went to Dublin, where he ministered to soldiers in Trinity College, who were helping to put down the Easter Rising, and then went out to Mesopotamia. And Father Farrell, who later became administrator of the cathedral here, but died prematurely, possibly as a result of his health being damaged by the war, was one of many clergy of all denominations who served with great distinction during the Great War. Another was Father John Coughlin from Castle Pollard, who enlisted as a chaplain in 1915, initially with the Enniskillen Fusiliers Regiment. He was wounded at Passchendaele in 1917, but recovered, was mentioned in dispatches twice, and would stay as a military chaplain right through the interwar period, serving all over the world, and in the Second World War would become the most senior Roman Catholic chaplain in the British Army, with over 700 priests under his control. There was a Father Glynn from Colucan, who won the Military Cross for bravery, a Father Daly, who also served with distinction. And these clergy often put themselves at great risk, going into the front line to help wounded men, to give the last rites. One soldier wrote back about the fervour with which they prayed the rosary, and particularly the lines about now and at the hour of our death, before going into battle. And the clergy came from all denominations, and the Protestant Bishop of Meath in 1915 wrote in his diary about a visit he made to Mullingar, and how Mullingar was quite the most interesting parish in the diocese, although he didn't elaborate on what made it so interesting. But the clergy were often very heroic men indeed, and quite a number of them lost their lives. And one particularly remembers Father Willie Doyle of the Royal Dublin Fusiliers, who was revered by men of all faiths, including hardline Orangemen, because of the risk he took and the way he looked after his men. He was killed at Passchendaele in 1917. And during the war too, Bishop Gowran, the Roman Catholic Bishop of Meath, did his bit for the war effort by having the grounds of the cathedral here in Mullingar turned over for food production. By 1917, there were shortages of food in the country because nothing could be imported, and farmers were urged to grow as much food as they could on every acre of land available. And so Bishop Gowran had the cathedral grounds turned over to food production, the food being provided to the poor in Mullingar, because by 1917, 1918, many of the people of this town were suffering very badly from shortages of fuel, shortages of food. There was a great row, in fact, in the House of Commons in 1918 when an MP for Longford, Mr. Farrell, raised the question of what had happened to coal that was supposed to be sent to the asylum, St. Lomond's Hospital now, but apparently had been diverted to Guinness's brewery instead. And he proclaimed that lunatics, even Irish lunatics, deserved to be kept warm and looked after. So all sections of the community were involved in the war effort, but it's worth remembering the heroic clergy of all denominations who did their bit during the First World War and looked after the men under their command, often with great diligence. The role of women from Westmeath during the war is also something which should not be forgotten about. We're marking this year the centenary of women getting the vote in Ireland and Britain, and that was in part a thank you to the women of Britain and Ireland for their part in the war effort. And many women from this county and this town served in the war as nurses, and they ran hospitals. For example, the Bloomfield Hotel 100 years ago was actually a Red Cross hospital for wounded soldiers, not just Irish soldiers, but even had soldiers from France there at one stage. The matron of the hospital was Mrs. Mary Locke of Locke's Distillery in Kilbeggan. A nurse Waters from the county infirmary asked for leave so that she could join the Red Cross, and she sent back letters from somewhere in France where she was attached to a Red Cross hospital. And one of the saddest cases was Nurse Elif from Castletown Gagan, who was working in a military hospital in London, and she picked up an infection, some kind of septicemia, from an injured soldier and died from the disease herself. That, of course, was in a pre-antibiotics age. There was a nurse from the Athlone area, Nurse Ellis, who went out with the Scottish ambulance service to work in Serbia. Serbia suffered more than most countries during that war because the country was invaded by the Austrians and Germans, and a quarter of the population of Serbia died in the conflict, mostly from diseases like typhus. And she herself, Nurse Ellis, was a prisoner of war for a time in Hungary. And on the home front, women were assiduous in raising funds. There was the Leinster Regiment Comforts Fund here in Mullingar, and they raised thousands at an auction in the county hall in January 1916. One of the items auctioned was a goat. It was bought and sold 26 times and became a regimental mascot. And they were also involved, along with children, in collecting sphagnum moss, which played a vital part in medical treatment in that pre-antibiotic age. And women also went to work in munitions factories in the greater Dublin area, in Wicklow, and in Britain as well. A highly dangerous job, and quite a number of women were killed in explosions in munitions factories during the war. And the journey for nurses who worked overseas was also dangerous. Women were killed in air raids, they were killed in shell attacks on dressing stations near the front line. So the role of women from Westmeath in the Great War is also something which has to be remembered. And of course, women were also involved during the war in the anti-conscription campaign. Just in the summer of 1918, over 1,000 women marched through the streets of Mullingar and hundreds more in towns and villages across the county to sign a pledge protesting against attempts to extend conscription to Ireland. So in all aspects of the war, Westmeath women played a role. This is the Westmeath ambulance, and this was one of the things that was done by the civilian population of Westmeath to help the army during the war. Fundraising took place across the county to provide an ambulance which could go up to the front line and bring back wounded soldiers. And the ambulance, having been paid for, was provided by the Mullingar Motor Company. They were based on Castle Street in the town at a time when not many people in Westmeath had cars. There were probably less than 100 motor vehicles in the Mullingar area when the war began, although the number increased during the conflict. But this is it, the Westmeath ambulance. We're very proud of it. All classes of people in the town contributed money towards it. And one of the drivers was Mr. Hornage, a retired soldier who lived out near Belvedere House. And it was a risky business because on one occasion, a shell landed close to the ambulance as it was driving up to the front line, and the driver had a narrow escape from death. Even behind the front lines, life could be quite dangerous. And this is the ambulance, paid for by the people of Westmeath and sent up to the front line, and probably played a part in saving the lives of many soldiers. During the First World War, a figure of between 35 and 50,000. They're still not absolutely certain because there were Irishmen serving in British regiments and not everyone in an Irish regiment was Irish, but something between 35 and 49,000 Irishmen lost their lives in that conflict. And it's important that they are commemorated and remembered because the First World War is a very important part of Ireland's history, and for far too long it was swept out of our history and out of our memory, and so it's time we brought it back. And that is what the service here in Mullingar on November the 11th is intended to do. The service here at All Saints Church, to which all are welcome, will remember all those from this town and this county and this country who lost their lives in the First World War, and indeed those who lost their lives in the Second World War and on UN service as well. The service is at 10:30, and at 11 o'clock, exactly 100 years to the minute after the armistice which ended the conflict, there will be a silence observed, and the service will be attended by members of the Royal British Legion from the Midlands of Ireland, and also by the ONE, by the United Nations Veterans, the Gardaí, Civil Defence, and other organisations around this town. And it will remember all those from this town who went to serve Ireland in the Great War, so many of whom never came back.